Hi, you're watching New York State Legislative Report with Senator Mark Grisanti. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, the Senator and I are going to talk about what's going on in the New York State Senate. It's great to be with you, Senator.
Thank you very much. How are you doing?
Good.
Good.
You've shown your support for Native Americans in Western New York and are helping to advance a mechanism that would educate legislators on issues that affect Indian nations. So this way, they could come together with a better understanding of how everyone can work together for a better New York, really.
Right.
So let's go straight out to a recent news conference where you talk about this.
Being one of the very few that have come from the private sector, President Porter, I can tell you firsthand that I've seen, and through the Tribal Council, exactly what has taken place with regards to the Seneca and the Seneca Nations and promoting job growth in the Western New York region, in particular what was stated in the city of Niagara Falls, which is smack dab in the middle of my district. And on top of that, revenue and funds that come not just staying in the casino itself, but being utilized throughout the Western New York area to promote further job growth throughout that region. So, as I said, being from the private sector, coming from being an attorney, still being an attorney, I look forward to promoting everything that we are in agreement with and the items that we are not in agreement with, coming to a resolution that actually has a conclusion and doesn't stagnate and dwell and hinder and then die only to come up and resurface again. So I look forward, and I'm proud to be a part of this. And
right. So this is a committee on Native American relations, and right. About 15 other states have something like this in place?
Yeah, there are 15 other states. We'll be the first one in the Northeast region to actually have this particular commission. And the way I look at it is that over the years there's been no respect whatsoever between government and Native Americans. And I think the problem is they each have different issues in their own regions. But together, when you have treaties, when you have signed agreements, and they're not respected, you're not going to get respect back. So if the government comes in and tries to muscle, or on the other hand, if the Senecas come in and try to muscle certain ways, that's not the way to do it. You have to be open. You have to be able to communicate. There's always pending legislation out there. I know recently in the Western District of New York, the federal government has ruled that they can start collecting taxes on cigarette sales. And when that whole process first started, I have information, and I'm sure everybody else does, that there's graphs that show that once a tax increase on cigarettes in New York State, it's not that most of them went to Native American lands. They went actually to Pennsylvania. They went to all the states that border New York. And that's where we lost our tax revenue. And I think it totaled at that time roughly $15 million in a short period of time. So there's got to be some give and take and some negotiations rather than just everybody saying, I'm right or you're right, and nothing gets done.
Right. And each nation, each Indian nation, is different. The Seneca Nation president talked about this at a news conference. He says that it's really important to have a system in place for legislators to communicate better.
Right.
So let's take a listen to that right
now. Okay.
Each one of our nations is a separate sovereign nation. And we have a unique history, and we also have a unique history with the state. At the same time, it makes sense that the state might want to standardize its approach to dealing with certain issues. But the point being is that over time, the legislature has not been a participant in this process at all, and it has been largely subject to the sort of ebb and flow of the executive. And that has resulted in a great degree of irregularity, of inconsistency, of real dysfunction as you look over the decades. So one of the things that we would hope to work with the committee on is to educate and to inform so that the legislative body understands the differences that exist within our nations. We have different forms of government. We have different approaches and different philosophies. And I think that that is the foundation of having good relations in the future. And whether contracts or compacts or agreements emerge, that would be a completely separate thing.
Do you have anything to comment on President Porter?
You know, I think President Porter hits a nail on the head because each nation is different. And what he is trying to say is that they need to have an open line of communication, as we talked about prior. You want to educate your legislators as to what the needs are, not only with people that are in your within your district, but everybody that's involved in your district. And there are Seneca Nations that they vote, and you have to listen to them. They're your constituents as well. So for him, it's a matter of really coming to the forefront and saying, I'm willing to work with you, we're willing to resolve some of these issues, but you have to understand the history of what these issues are, and let's move forward. If you keep dwelling in the past, that's what I meant by saying it's going to stagnate and nothing's going to get done.
What's going on with UB 2020? Do you have any updates on that?
Yeah, UB 2020, in the past couple of weeks, new President Tripathi was sworn in as the UB president, and he is the original architect of UB 2020. I think he's taken a step back by saying, you know what, 5 years ago when UB 2020 was first on the forefront, this was something that would have worked immediately. There was, you know, there was funding in place at that time by Governor, then Governor Elliott Spitzer. Governor Patterson was on board with it. But then with all the dysfunction that happened in Albany in the last few years, it kind of went by the wayside, got distorted as to what the project was. And I think President Tripathi has now stated, you know, rather than do a whole structure of rebuild for the entire University of Buffalo campus, which is the North Campus, the South Campus, and downtown Buffalo, which is where they're going to move their medical site, he has stated, let's just focus on the medical site in downtown Buffalo. We'll leave the North and the South campuses their particular work for later on. And I think that's smart because, first of all, the funding's not there. The economies have changed in the last few years. And what the governor decided to do, he was asked by three other schools, Binghamton, Albany, and Stony Brook, to be allowed to come into the picture of UB 2020, which is now, UB 2020 hasn't changed, but the governor's decided to call his proposal dealing with the regional council New York SUNY 2020, or SUNY New York 2020. And he is funding that with roughly $140 million to allow the research institutes, the four of them, Albany, Binghamton, Stony Brook, and Buffalo, to present their plan to the regional council. And with that plan, if the plan's approved, they get additional $35 million in capital money for some of the projects. In his interview, Governor Cuomo has stated that he expects UB to submit their UB 2020 plan. They're the only ones at this point in time that actually have a plan that's at completion, shovel-ready site, ready to go. So the $35 million, on top of the money that came from the budget that was reallocated from last year for UB 2020, that's what's going to be utilized in the forefront. You already have procurement that was passed in the budget, but now you got to deal with, still, same issue, public-private partnerships, and what are you doing about tuition? So, and we know that we took care of tuition in the bill by giving breaks to people making $60,000. None of that has changed. So the question is, do we stay with that tuition proposal, or do we lower the percentage of what tuition can increase by? And that's the things that are going to be discussed, not only in phone calls now that we are going to be doing weekly with UB, but on May 17th, we're supposed to have a summit showing the UB 2020 plan. They're going to make the presentation, and there's going to be support by the Senate. There's going to be support by the governor. And there are, if there are still some unresolved issues between the Assembly and Assembly Chairwoman Glick for Higher Education and Speaker Shelley Silver, then hopefully those issues can be resolved. But the governor has stated to me that he wants to get this done in a session. It's important for Western New York, and it needs to move forward.
Yeah, it's important for Western New York. It's important, really, for all New York, because you're just trying to develop and to keep people in New York as
exactly.
Well. With this year's budget that closed a $10 billion deficit, made tough choices. I produced a video that shows the majority explaining their vote for why control is spending and not adding any more taxes is going to put New York on a better path. Let's take a look at it.
Send a message to the business community that New York State is prepared to work with you, not stand in your way, the creation of jobs.
You know, one of the priorities that we had through this budget process was to remember that there are people out there that are in real need.
It's a time for serious consideration of the dire economic consequences faced by every tax-paying citizen of this state, every job producer of this state.
A month ago, a company by the name of Luminite, family-owned business that's been in the city of Salamanca for 85 years, decided to move out of New York State.
New York State has a spending problem. if we keep taxing, we're going to keep running people out of the state of New York.
And they said to us, you know what, we know some people in Albany like you and the governor are trying to change the business climate, but we can't take the heavy taxes anymore. We can't take the heavy regulations.
We have to work harder together to free up restrictions on businesses. The taxes and the fees that were issued the last 2 years were ridiculous.
We have no future in this state continuing to be number one in all the wrong ways. Number one in killing jobs, number one in taxing.
That's what that side of the aisle, the Senate Democrats, have consistently done over the past 2 years. You raised 124 new taxes and fees.
124 new taxes.
To the tune of some $14 billion.
At a time when people could least afford it.
Not taking into account what the aftermath would be, as if we could go on forever.
When they had trouble paying their utility bills, you taxed them even more. When they had trouble paying their property taxes, you taxed them even more. When they had trouble paying their health insurance premiums, you taxed them even more. You tax their motor vehicle registrations.
In order to do something down the road, you have to make changes today.
Business as usual in state government has become unsustainable and unacceptable.
You can't keep on spending money that you don't have. The controller indicated the last couple of years that level of spending was not sustainable.
We have a $10 billion deficit. We have to live in the real world.
We're not only tackling the deficit this year, but tackling the future deficits. By not taxing, by creating the opportunity for job growth, cutting government waste, duplicative services.
With every challenge comes an opportunity to save dollars and also improve services for the people of New York.
Because it's sending a clear message to the people of the state and the people of this country that this heavy taxation will not continue.
Making money, hiring employees. The more employees, the more the tax base, the more the tax base, the less the burden on individuals.
We've got to turn this state around, and that's what this budget is about.
It's loud and clear that we're not imposing a new tax.
So you've had listening tours around your district. What are people saying about the budget?
Well, the people are saying basically what just happened in this recent budget by being passed on time with no new taxes and fees, by cutting government waste and spending, and by having the tools and the opportunity to create jobs, they're receptive to that. They understand it's the infant stages. They understand that this budget this year wasn't an easy budget to pass because it was a budget that was painful. But in our committee, we made the budget a little bit better by restoring funding to certain areas that were needed in schools and prescriptions and other areas. But the main point is that I think people are seeing that this is a time now where they can move forward. And by getting rid of these regulations for jobs, people that want to come into New York State, freeing up these regulations, getting rid of the bureaucratic red tape, I think is going to make us more productive. It's already happening in my region, and the Niagara Falls Airport now is expanding its growth, and by them having its expansion, they're stealing businesses from Southern Ontario region, Niagara Falls, Ontario. They're building hotels there. Recently met with an individual regarding wanting to put a National Comedy Hall of Fame in Niagara Falls that would create jobs and have other jobs spur off from that. Still working with you on UB 2020. So these are still the focuses, is no taxes, create jobs, and keep government spending down. And we're happy with that. $14 billion in 2 years was a lot of money in taxes and fees that hit New York State, and in particular Western New York, who has the biggest population loss in this last census than anybody in the state.
Yeah, and at a really hard time. So you have another listening session coming up this week.
Thursday it's coming up in Niagara Falls, and I'm sure we'll have a lot of people turn out for that, and we could talk about it next time.
Great. Thanks so much for being with us.
All right. Thank you very much.
For more information, you can log on to the Senator's website, grisanti.nysenate.gov.